I'm with Dr. Shai, who's a member of the Knesset. Now, Dr. Shai, what is life like for you representing your country as a member of the Knesset?
Well, it's a commitment, it's a mission, and it's a big honor. I was elected to the Knesset for the first time 9 years ago, and I've been serving my country, my people, and my party since then. And I believe, strongly believe, that serving in the Knesset will give me, and actually does already, a chance or opportunity to apply ideas and ideology that I believe in.
As we come up to Israel's 70th birthday, what threats does Israel face today?
Well, there's no shortage in threats on Israel from day one. And even before, there were enemies surrounding Israel. And we had to fight very hard and with a lot of pain and blood that we've been paying for our survival and our independence. The first war was 1948, and since then we actually have been fighting at least once in a decade, 56, 67, 73, 82, 91. And since then, mainly, I would say, 2006, there were different kind of, the warfare has changed. And now we are dealing with what we call the limited wars. But it doesn't change the character of wars where we lose our people, always the best of them, either in fighting or combating terror within Israel or around our borders. The recent threat on Israel is in the proximity of Iran to Israel. Iran is no longer far away from Israel, but actually it gets very close to the border, and we are faced with a threat from an enemy which is, I would say, much stronger, better equipped technologically, and with driven by ideology. And that means that Iran is a serious enemy of Israel.
Iran seems to be taking over a lot of this area with Syria and Lebanon. Is the rest of the world waking up to this, do you think?
No. The rest of the world is interested in making money and doing business. And once the sanctions were removed from Iran, from all over the world, states and business people turned to Iran and are helping, first helping it to recover from the long years of economic sanctions, and secondly, to prosper. And that makes it also quite not only a military power, but also economic one.
Do you feel that you could ever have peace with a country like Iran?
Well, we have had peace with Iran. I would say we wish to have peace with Iran, especially with the Iranian people, but not with the Iranian present regime, which is extremely extreme to the religiously. And I see no chance, unfortunately. But if we look backward till a little bit over 40 years ago, until the removal of the Shah, Israel and Iran had great relations in all levels, military, economic, and we would like very much to return to the good old days of Israeli-Iranian relations.
Is Gaza a threat today?
Gaza is a threat, but much different than Iran. Iran is a serious power, military power. Gaza can produce rockets, all kinds of mini threats on Israel, tunnels and so on. But that's not something that will really endanger the country. They don't have ballistic rockets, they don't have pilotless aircraft and so on and so forth. But our experience shows that since we have had at least three military engagements with Gaza, they can have a strong impact on the southern part of Israel, and the rockets ranges now up to Tel Aviv and Lod Airport and so on. So we don't want to see any more engagements, military engagements with Gaza. I think the solution to Gaza is try to help her to recover from the terrible poverty that they are living in. But we are not able to do it by ourselves. We need Egypt and we need some other states, and that hopefully will also help us to get rid of the Hamas, which is a very ideologically, again, religiously and ideologically an enemy of Israel.
Do you see Hamas's ideology exactly the same as ISIS?
I'm not an expert on that. The bottom line is that Hamas ideology is to destroy Israel, to get rid of Israel. ISIS is not focusing just on Israel. For ISIS, it's against the world, against the Western world, against the Western culture, against the world, the Western values. So it's much more global than Hamas. But if you put them in the same context, Hamas in Sinai, from which they choose Sinai as one of their present bases, they've been producing some terror attacks against Israel, but most of the time they are dealing with the Egyptian army, which is trying to get them out of Sinai. But there are, as we know, links between the Hamas in Gaza and ISIS in the Sinai. We are aware of it, we are watching it, and we are cooperating with the Egyptians how to stop it.
Now, Donald Trump has recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. How did you feel when you heard that news?
Well, I'm a Jerusalemite. I was born in this city 70 years ago. I love the city very much, and I think that this is the most important decision Trump has made since he became president, at least from our perspective, I'll be honest with you. But I feel one of the major ones, because he showed the qualities of a leader, because he went against his advisors, against the establishment in the United States, against the State Department. And he proved that once you are ready to make decisions, well, sometimes you're wrong, but in this case, he was right. He was right, first of all, because it was a fact of life. Jerusalem has been the capital of Israel historically, and then since 1948. And secondly, not too much has happened. There were, you know, expectations, and they haven't materialized at all. So I thank him very much. And in your language, I'm sure that God has been helping us a lot, from wherever he is, to achieve that goal. Jerusalem, as I said before, is the place of the temple, is a place that every Jew prays every day, wherever he is or she is. That's the heart of the Jewish people. And as we know, not just the Jewish people. Now the U.S. Embassy is moving to Jerusalem as well, from Tel Aviv. That's another step. And again, I should thank and praise President Trump for this decision and for its implication, because it goes on and on. And by the way, I hope very much that it would not stop the chances or the prospects for peace between us and the Palestinians. I think they should just accept it as is. And well, maybe next time Israel will have to show some flexibility, and why not?
Guatemala is planning to move its embassy as well. Do you think other countries will follow suit?
Well, one after the other. I remember the times where there were scores of embassies and foreign representations in Jerusalem. They all moved out of the city in 67 and later on. Yes, there's no reason why not. Jerusalem was chosen by the people of Israel and by the government to be the capital of Israel. And as much as we respect their capitals, they should respect ours too.
Now, last week it was announced that Prince William is coming to Israel. Is this another significant event for Israel's 70th anniversary?
That's a miracle. It shows that we live in an era of miracles, because up until now, none of the members of the royal family, the British royal family, has ever been to Israel, except state funerals. And this was very short. They were short visits. I think it shows something, maybe too late. I was born under British government. I was born under Palestine government, and I would like to see the Brits again, not ruling the country, but visiting the country. I think it's an important step. I don't know who was standing behind, and maybe it shows that finally, after 70 years, Britain accepted the very fact that they were literally kicked out of the Middle East and from Israel. And okay, after 70 years, it's time to wake up and say, we are not going back. Israel is independent. Israel is the state of the Jewish people. And we come and visit with you. That's fine.
We're celebrating 50 years of the reunification of Jerusalem and 70 years of the state of Israel. Is there going to be very big celebrations this year?
Yeah, well, of course, the largest one I can imagine. But it's not only a question of the magnitude. It's important to show that we, the Jewish people, are back in their homeland, that we, third time in our history, have an independent entity, a state, with government, that this is a democratic state, which is extremely important to us to keep the democratic values and the democratic regime in Israel, and to preserve the democratic values. I think it's the number 70 speaks for itself, and I'm just expecting for another 70 years for eternal ones, you know. Israel will remain forever.
With those 70 years, Israel has had to fight to survive. Do you see that that's a miracle that Israel exists today?
You can frame it as a miracle. Sometimes we say miracle, I'm not sure that we always mean a miracle, but if you come from a religious point of view, yes, it is a miracle. If you just look backward where we were in 1948, 600,000 Jews, 6,000 of them were killed in the war. The prospects was very slim to survive. There was nothing to start from. And if you look at Israel today, one of the leading states on earth, technologically, scientifically, we renew our culture. The Hebrew language is being spoken here all over. And of course, it's a safe place for Jews for the third time in our history, but first time in our modern history, the Jews have a place to come, a safe place. Of course, wars you mentioned here and there, but at the end of the day, all the world is surrounded with wars and enemies and animosity. So, yes, it's a miracle.
Now, you wrote a book called Media War. Tell us a little bit about that.
Media War is my own interpretation of the wars that we are fighting our days, which is the war on what we call the war on hearts and minds, the conscious war. You have to, it's not like past war that you have to defeat the enemy. There's no, what does it mean to defeat? What does it mean to win? What does victory mean? This word has to get new interpretation. In media, you have, I have detected the special role of the media in the war, in shaping the public opinion, both inside and outside, and creating, again, the impact on your enemy. You deter the enemy from either starting the war or continuing the war. And as I said before, it's not by taking over its territory, but it's by taking over its hearts and mind. The enemy or the people that are fighting you will understand that there's no reason, there's no room and no chance to win the war against Israel. So it's actually a combination of military, diplomatic, and other kinds of warfare. All are directed at the conscience of your enemy. And by the way, we are not the only one in the world today. The Americans, the Brits, other states also follow this concept that modern wars are different than previous ones and in this essence.
When it comes to Israel, do you think the media is very anti-Semitic?
Well, no, I wouldn't say anti-Semitic, but there's no other state that has been covered or reported by the media so much. We're not always happy, but we learn to live with the media. Actually, in our world today, there are alternative ways to engage public opinion. You can do it mainly through social networks. You can do it by people to people. You are not dependent on the media, or you are much less dependent on the media than you were in the past. So we have one hand extended to the media, but the other hand is working very hard on the iPhone or the internet or the alternative networks, and you can reach many people and convince them to help Israel. And on this, I should praise many friends of Israel all around the world, not only Jews but Christians that love Israel, that would like Israel to survive, that believe that Israel's existence is important to the world, it's important to them, it's important to God, and they do help us. And you reach not through the media, you reach them through social networks or alternative ways, and you recruit them or mobilize them to this major effort to keep Israel alive.
Now we have many Christians around the world that do love and support Israel. What can they pray for Israel?
Israel for peace, for safety, prosperity, and look at the geopolitical picture here. It looks like something impossible, but since God has been so helpful in the past, they should pray to God to be helpful to Israel And by that, no one can will ever be able to defeat us or to beat us or to make any harm to the Jewish people.
Okay, Dr. Shai, thank you very much.
You're most welcome. Thank you very much.